Hello. For the third and probably final time in this unit, I'm Mr. Steele, and I'm here to work through another topic from the Trig Identities unit of study in the Accelerated Math course, or possibly Pre-Cal or Honors Pre-Cal, whatever course you might be taking right now. In this video, I'm going to kind of wrap up this idea of using and representing and simplifying trig identities by talking about the concept called verifying trig identities, which, if I'm being completely honest, is really just simplifying trig identities, but someone tells you the answer ahead of time, so you know exactly what your destination is. So having said that, though, there are some specific rules, and there are definitely some strategies here. Now, we're going to pull our punches a little bit and only give you some I'll call them some really approachable identities to work with, especially on the assignment. I've kind of cut it back and made it so that you don't have to do these super advanced techniques or ones that involve many, many steps. We're going to keep it really simple, but at the same time, it just didn't feel complete without at least taking an opportunity to kind of demonstrate the approaches you can take when you're trying to show that a particular trig identity actually holds. So now, as you can see on this first page, the instructions say the definition of verify says to demonstrate the equality of two expressions by transforming one side into the other via the fundamental identities. So that's our goal here. So we want to be able to take a complicated, really crunchy expression with a bunch of different trig pieces in there, and we want to find a way to clean it up so that we can see that, oh, that side suddenly is equal to the other side. So like I said, it really is just simplifying with someone telling you what the answer is so that you know exactly what destination you're pursuing. So I have down here just kind of a quick introductory example that I can use to bring up a couple ideas before we go in and talk about specific strategies and do a number of examples. So on this first one, which actually comes directly out of the AP Calculus course, by the way, you're asked to verify that sine squared plus cosine squared over cosine squared is equal to secant squared. So now, as you go to attack this, like, it's very important to follow a single piece of information on here, and it's one that doesn't necessarily come out everywhere. This is just kind of the way we do it at Franklin, but it says in our definition of verify that we're going to transform one side into the other. So the best way to describe this is that when you look at an identity like this, we're going to pick out one of those sides, and we're going to work from there to the other side, making the other side kind of like the destination. So the best way I could think of to describe why we do it this way comes from thinking about a treasure map. So R, X marks the spot R. So let's say you've got a treasure map. I don't know what happens on a treasure map. And you're told that you're supposed to follow this pathway, and eventually you get to X, where the treasure is. Let's see if I can draw a little. There we go. Shiny stuff. There it is. Boom, boom, boom. Okay. Looks kind of like a souffle. Okay, whatever. So in other words, if you're trying to pursue and like solve this treasure map, you can't simply like work your way through partway and then have someone else work their way back, because that's not going to result in you being at the treasure. Our treasure is reaching the X, where X marks the spot, R. I'm trying to find another R in there. So our goal here isn't just to have the two sides meet and end up with two things being equal to one another, because these things are already equal to one another. Instead, our goal is to get to the actual destination. So for instance, in this first identity that we're going to look at, I'm going to start over here, and I'm going to make this into my treasure. So I'm going to try to reach the secant squared, so that way I've gotten all the way to the treasure, I can dig it up, and I don't know, I can be rich forever, I have no idea, whatever. So on the left side, if we're going to attack this, it's important to look at what identities we can actually use. Well, right up on top, I notice sine squared plus cosine squared. That's a Pythagorean identity, and in fact, on that left side, it transforms the numerator into 1 instead of sine squared plus cosine squared, so it cleans up quite a bit. That means we now have 1 over cosine squared on the left side. And on the right side, since we can't touch it, our treasure remains secant squared. It's not exactly the most glorious treasure in the world, but bear with me. Now, we can already see that these two things are exactly the same, but at this point, we can only do one thing. If we want to turn the left side into the right side, we can apply the reciprocal identity and rewrite 1 over cosine squared as secant squared of x. Then that's going to be equal to the right side, which already says secant squared of x, which means we're done. So having said that, that's the path that we followed over here on the right side. That's us reaching the treasure. What some people are tempted to do is they're tempted to do something like, oh, I'll just multiply cosine squared on both sides. Actually, it's not even the best way that people might do it. They might just go, oh, on the right side, I'm going to change that and make that 1 over cosine squared. Because then in their mind, they go, oh, 1 over cosine squared equals 1 over cosine squared. Unfortunately, that is what happened on the treasure map on the right side, where one person left the treasure and came and met up somewhere else along the pathway. It's just not the process that we're looking for. We want to turn one side into the other. So again, we just work on that one side, and then we slowly work our way through. Now, having said that, it makes it sound like it's very simple. And the truth is, like, verifying trig identities is really just relying on you knowing the fundamental trig identities and being able to throw them out there when you see them. Having said that, though, it's often nice to have a little bit of guidance and give you some ideas about what are some good approaches that you might take to effectively and efficiently attack a particular identity. So I have a few steps here. Not all of them are going to require an example. I think it's like 4 or 5 require an example. The others are just kind of info. But again, take this at whatever pace you need to. So tip number one, the first one we're going to look at here, says to work on the more complicated side. The truth is, I feel like this is fairly obvious, only because if you're trying to go from one direction to the other, it's a lot easier to start with something really crunchy than it is to start with something really clean and then just kind of mess it up. Now, anyone that's ever cleaned their room or cleaned their house knows that it's probably easier in the real world to just make things more complicated and messy. But the truth is, it doesn't work that way here. We want to have a whole bunch of ingredients and a simple destination, and that should speed up our process. So when I look at the expression on the left side and I start to attack this identity, clearly my left side is the more complicated side. So I'm going to work on simplifying that left side. The first thing that catches my eye is that secant of x can be rewritten as 1 over cosine of x. And you can probably predict why I did that. It's because I see that cosine. And then with the sine over cosecant, I don't necessarily see a good way to rewrite that yet. So I'm just going to rewrite it as sine of x times 1 over cosecant of x. The thought process being maybe that will clean something up for me. It's just kind of a good strategy to kind of let us see what's happening here. Now on the left side, I see cosine and cosine divide out. That leaves us with just 1. And on the right side, or the right next to the minus sign, we have sine of x times cosecant of x, or 1 over cosecant of x. 1 over cosecant of x using a reciprocal identity is equal to sine of x. So we now have that 1 minus sine of x times sine of x is equal to cosine of x. Now from there, if we wanted to clean this up, this isn't too far to go from now. We recognize that that's just 1 minus sine squared of x, and that's equal to cosine squared of x. And at this point, I'd say that if you recognize this on the left side as cosine squared of x, you could just go right to it. And in fact, I feel pretty confident saying that the left side is cosine squared and the right side is cosine squared. So in other words, I would feel safe saying that we're done. If that doesn't appeal to you, though, and I realize that there's probably a few of you out there that are just like, wait, that's just kind of cheap. Isn't that just kind of like saying the two things are the same? Fair enough. What you could do instead is you could rewrite that 1 using the Pythagorean identity and say that, well, 1 is sine squared plus cosine squared, which means that we're taking sine squared plus cosine squared and subtracting sine squared, not changing the right side, of course. Once we do that, sine squared minus sine squared goes away. And there we end up with cosine squared equals cosine squared. So some might say this is a little over pedantic. It's like me just kind of doing extra steps. But the truth is, I can definitely see the argument that this might feel best. Now, in looking at all these different things, it's worth pointing out, by the way, that we used, not the quotient identity. We used some reciprocal identities. And I'm going to abbreviate them in this case. We used a reciprocal identity there. We used a reciprocal identity there as well, the 1 over cosecant. And then from there, we used a Pythagorean identity. So we already got a good collection of identities in there, and they allowed us to eventually show that this complicated looking left side was actually equal to this nice, fairly clean right side. So again, starting with the more complicated sign is just a really good strategy to give you some tools to play with a little bit as you start to verify. The second one we'll look at, it's probably the simplest one of the ones that are in here, but it says for our second tip that we're going to substitute with fundamental identities to start to simplify. And this is kind of what we already did, but it's a really important statement to make nonetheless. When you see an expression, you want to try to transform it by plugging in the simplest, cleanest identities that you can. So for instance, when I look at this identity, secant times cotangent equals cosecant of theta, there are lots of different ways that I could go to attack this thing. I could do all sorts of reciprocal identities, but I'm going to start with some really basic ones. Secant of theta, I'm going to apply the reciprocal identity to, and I'm going to write it as 1 over cosine of theta. That's just the most fundamental relationship for secant, so I'm going to start there. Likewise, for cotangent, it's tempting to do 1 over tangent just because, hey, we're already in a reciprocal mood, let's try it. But instead, seeing this cosine down there in the denominator, I'm thinking a quotient identity would actually be more prudent. I'll rewrite cotangent as cosine over sine. And of course, none of this changes our right side, because that's our x marks the spot. That's where we're trying to finish everything off at. Having done that, now that we've applied, and I should probably be tracking these as we go, I applied a reciprocal identity, and I also applied, the quotient identity. So we had a couple different IDs there. From here, if we want to wrap this thing up, I noticed that the cosines divide out, and we're just left with 1 over sine of theta is equal to the right side, cosecant of theta. And of course, we know that's true, but to wrap this up, I just want to rewrite the left side as cosecant of theta, so that that way we have cosecant of theta equal to cosecant of theta, and we've verified this out. So my last step was to apply one more reciprocal identity. And actually, I didn't really apply it on that line, I applied it on the last line. But there we go. So again, bring in those fundamental identities, and really, the simpler you can put in, the better. That oftentimes cleans things up and makes it really comfortable, because again, if you know sine and cosine the best, getting a bunch of identities with sines and cosines plugged in using those basic identities will often lead you in a good direction. The third one we're going to look at, I think I actually may have two of these as examples here. It tells us to look to factor, multiply, or add fractions. So in this case, we've got lots of different things that are there. I don't see any fractions in this one like we will in the next example. So I'm thinking instead, a good option would be to multiply. Let's just multiply this thing out. And in fact, as I look at it, I notice that this fits that difference of squares structure that we've used so many times before. It's a plus b times a minus b. So that automatically tells me that I can rewrite this expression as secant squared minus tangent squared. And supposedly, what this is going to be equal to is going to be equal to 1. Now from here, if I want to attack, I haven't done any identity work really so far. What I notice is that I've got these squares, and I also see a combination of secant and tangent, which makes me think of the Pythagorean identities. So my thought is, the next step that I'm going to take is going to be a Pythagorean identity. The problem is, secant squared and tangent squared, maybe you just don't have them in your head. So as a reminder, if you're not a memorizer, a good place to begin to get these identities really fast is to think of it as sine squared plus cosine squared equals 1, the most basic version of the Pythagorean identity. And then since we want to secant, we need to divide everything by cosine squared. So I'll divide all the terms by cosine squared. When I do, I'll get sine squared over cosine squared is tangent squared, plus cosine squared over cosine squared, which is 1. And that's, of course, equal to secant squared of theta. So having seen this, having had this version in there, which of course you could also, by the way, remember as I tan by the C, so you could also remember it that way, same thing. What I notice is that this gives us a prescription to substitute for secant squared. So I'm gonna go ahead and make that substitution. Secant squared, I'm gonna be rewriting as 1 plus tangent squared of theta. So that's gonna be my replacement for secant squared. The rest of our identity stays the same, the minus tangent squared and equals 1. And then look for just exactly what we said would happen, tangent squared minus tangent squared, those guys zero out. And that leaves us with 1 equals 1. And I am pretty sure that's not even a trig identity, that's just kind of the thing. The multiplicative identity is equal to itself. So having said that, in this case, we did very little trig. We just did some multiplication. We used difference of squares to multiply something out. As soon as we saw those squared tangents and secants, we thought of the Pythagorean identity. So however we got there, we were able to make a substitution and then quickly work our way through. Now, that's not always going to be the case. It's not always going to be a simple multiplication away from cleaning itself up. In this example, a second one to go along with that third tip about factoring and multiplying, it doesn't necessarily jump out at me which way we're going to go through. So instead, I'm going to rewrite this in a way that might not immediately jump out at you, but will hopefully actually clean things up for us. I'm going to do a particular type of factoring here. That factoring strategy isn't what we think of as factoring, though. It's taking this 1 plus cosecant over secant and rewriting it as 1 over secant plus cosecant over secant. So in a sense, that's kind of like factoring out 1 over secant and then distributing it into the two terms. It's not exactly the classic strategy, but it does a really nice job. Now this hasn't cleaned up everything for us yet. We're supposed to show that the left side's equal to cosine, and there's just a lot going on the left side. I do notice, though, that the first term is going to be equal to cosine of theta. So that helps a little bit. But my problem is really right here. So we've got all this stuff going on. I'll go ahead and fill out the rest of it. We've got a lot of stuff going on, but our real issue is with cosecant of theta over secant of theta. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to rewrite this. I'm going to rewrite it as cosecant of theta times 1 over secant of theta. This sort of decomposition really does seem to help because it just lets us analyze things a little bit separately. Now, I can tell based on all this that if I want the left side and right side to be equal, this pink expression needs to be equal to cotangent. So that way it will zero out with this and it will give us just cosine equals cosine. Problem is, I definitely don't see cotangent as I look at cosecant over secant. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to apply some more identities to this. As we said, the cosine part is staying the same, and we still haven't been able to make any headway getting rid of cotangent. But if we rewrite the pink section as instead using reciprocal identities, cosecant would be 1 over sine, and 1 over secant would be cosine. And that's a huge move, because if you look at this expression now, on the left side, the pink version, which is 1 over sine times cosine, can be rewritten really cleanly as cosine of theta over sine of theta. And the reason I bring that up, and the reason I bring that point that out, is because cosine over sine is the quotient identity. Cosine over sine, and I'll just keep it in pink here one more time. Actually, let's do this. Sorry, trying to do all of this at once and move quickly, it can be tough. So we know cosine over sine is equal to cotangent of theta. And just as we've seen so many times, that cotangent of theta and minus cotangent of theta zero out. That leaves us on the left cosine of theta, and on the right it leaves us, of course, cosine of theta. So we've once again verified the identity. In this case, it obviously took a little bit longer, especially because I wanted to do one little algebraic step each time. I'd say the biggest thing here was being comfortable separating those two fractions. So although maybe it's not the word we're thinking about, you might add even in there the idea that separating fractions might actually help out. It is truly just a GCF style, but at the same time, it might actually be the strategy that opens up an entire problem set for you. The fourth strategy is one that we're not planning to have you practice or demonstrate it all or use it all. It's just one that I want to show you. I'd say that oftentimes this is the most time-consuming one and the one that's most annoying, but it's still valuable and it's an important process in here to recognize in case it ever comes up for you. So what we have here is an identity where both sides actually look equally complicated to me. Cosine of x over 1 minus sine of x is supposed to equal 1 plus sine of x over cosine of x. And this one doesn't necessarily jump out. If we could work on both sides, I could see a pathway though. I could see cosine times cosine, if we multiplied through by the denominators, and 1 plus sine times 1 minus sine, I could see those working out nicely and giving me cosine squared equals 1 minus sine squared with a difference of squares. Having said that though, that's not an option for us. And tip 4 tells us what our resolution is. We're going to rationalize by using conjugates. Now that might not be a phrase that you're familiar with or super familiar with, at least especially in the context of trig identities, but here's what it looks like. Basically that denominator, 1 minus sine of x, doesn't give us anything as currently constructed. If it was 1 minus sine squared though, we'd be in business. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to force it to turn into 1 minus sine squared. I'm going to rewrite the denominator instead of just as 1 minus sine of x. I'm going to multiply by 1 plus sine of x to finish off a difference of squares, with the thought process being if that's a difference of squares, we have Pythagorean options. Now, of course, if we multiply the denominator by 1 plus sine of x, that does not excuse us from multiplying the numerator as well. So we need to multiply that through. And then, of course, our right side sticks along for the ride. Not yet doing anything, just kind of hovering around. I know using the treasure map example, it's kind of sitting there waiting for someone to deliver a shovel. So here we are. Now, what has just happened? Like, what did we just do? Well, this thing, which we can think of as like a conjugate, the same way 1 plus root 2 times 1 minus root 2 would be, it's done absolutely nothing in the numerator. In fact, I would not argue with you if you said that you gross, you just made the numerator worse. Yeah, I did. The numerator wasn't where our issue was. It was our denominator. 1 minus sine of x times 1 plus sine of x can be rewritten as 1 minus sine squared of x using a difference of squares. And yeah, it's still equal to this thing on the right side, 1 plus sine of x over cosine, but I think we're actually one step away from being able to see that finish line finally. Here's what I mean. Down below, 1 minus sine squared, that's part of the Pythagorean identity. In fact, I might argue that at this point, it'd be perfectly safe for us to just say that, well, 1 minus sine squared is equivalent to cosine squared. Because that's exactly true. Sine squared plus cosine squared equals 1, so 1 minus sine squared has to be equal to cosine squared. And although this doesn't immediately fix everything, it's really close. We now have cosine of x in the numerator and cosine squared of x in the denominator. That's the same thing as saying that our denominator features cosine of x times cosine of x. So what I can do is I can divide out the cosine of x factor right there. It leaves me just a single one in the denominator. Our left side now reads 1 plus sine of x. Our denominator of that left side is cosine of x. And what was it again we were supposed to show is equal to? 1 plus sine of x over cosine of x. Yeah, we're done. So as it turned out, we did have to make things worse for a little while by multiplying up and down by 1 plus sine of x, but that turned out to be the opening that we needed. That created a Pythagorean identity opportunity in the denominator, and then that allowed us to divide out one of the cosines and give us the exact thing that we were looking for on the right side. So again, if I was trying to give you a good strategy for when this is a good option, it's really when you have what looks like a wannabe Pythagorean identity without the squares. That just kind of suggests and screams like, hey, try to finish this off, like turn me into a difference of squares so we can use one of the Pythagorean identities. Now, as I said, we're not going to assess you on that. Your teachers are not going to assess you on that during this time, but in future courses, they very well will. So just to be aware, that's a technique that's out there as well. Now, tip number 5 is probably the easiest one. There's not much to say here, and in fact, there's not really any examples that I want to throw out there. Instead, it's just a note to remind you that if a structure suggests something, follow it through, use what you see. So in this case, there are a couple different structures that will immediately scream for a particular type of identity. Yeah, we mostly use reciprocal and quotient identities, but the truth is these other ones are possibilities as well. So the first one, if you see a trig function with pi over 2 minus theta in the argument, think to yourself about the likelihood that you'll need a cofunction identity. The truth is that's probably what's going to happen. And in fact, if I follow the naming patterns, trig of pi over 2 minus theta would be equal to cotrig, which is also known as that pre-calculus math course that's taught at the high school down the street from us. Ha, cotrig, ha. From there, likewise, if you see a negative x in an argument, that screams for an even odder identity. Heck, just listen really closely. I bet you can hear it. Evener. Yeah, see, it's right there. I can hear it myself. So again, think of those things and go that way. Last but not least, if you see a squared trig function, it's not necessarily going to be every single time this way, but it's very likely that what you're going to aim for is a Pythagorean identity. Pythagorean identities relate the squares of two different or three different pairs of trig ratios. If you see a squared one, maybe it's just waiting for you to make that substitution too. So again, if you see a particular structure screamed out at you, the right kind of argument or a square, take that as a hint and try to run with it in that direction. Odds are you'll end up in a good place, especially with those first two. Those first two, you kind of have to do it. Whew. Okay, tip number 6. I think this is the last intense one that we have to do through. As it says in tip number 6, if all else fails, if you can't think of anything else in the world to do, just try to make it a bunch of sines and cosines. The idea being sines and cosines are the ones we're most comfortable with and the ones that you've seen the most often. So why not turn it into something there and see if maybe that can't open things up. Now in this particular problem, if you know Pythagorean identities, and I'm guessing you probably do since you've watched some of those other videos, the truth is you might think to yourself Pythagorean identity is the right choice here. And you know what? You'd be completely correct. So for what we're going to do here, just for the purpose of kind of demonstrating this technique, I'm going to ask you to forget Pythagorean identities for a second. Just let's not think of that in this direction. Let's pretend that we don't recognize secant squared's relationship to tangent squared. So that's not an option for us. So we're looking at this. We're just stymied by it, not sure what's going to actually happen. So here's what I'm thinking. Let's transform this into a bunch of sines and cosines. So we know cotangent squared, well, we know cotangent is cosine over sine, so we'll rewrite the outside factor as cosine squared over sine squared. On the inside, secant we know is the reciprocal of cosine, so I'm going to rewrite this as 1 over cosine squared of theta minus 1. And of course, our goal is to show that the left side equals the right side. So we want to show that everything on the left turns into 1. Well, let's see what happens here. At this point, what I'm going to do is I'm going to distribute that in. Again, this is just one strategy. There's lots of ones out there. Actually, do I want to do that? You know what? I'm not gonna. I'm going to do something different. I'm going to try to take things. I'm going to live on the wild side here. What I'm going to do is I'm going to try to find a common denominator. I think that's actually going to be a faster method. So again, if you saw the other way and you wanted to go that route, be my guest. Like, there's nothing stopping you from it. That's going to absolutely work too. It's just a matter of taking some time to get there. Oops. Okay, so from here we have 1 minus cosine squared, 1 over cosine squared minus 1. I'm going to multiply up and down by cosine squared, which means we'll end up with 1 over cosine squared minus cosine squared over cosine squared. As we've said before, that doesn't actually fix anything for us. Like, in a sense, it just kind of adds a level of complexity. But remember, our goal of doing that is to get a common denominator. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to rewrite this so it instead becomes 1 minus cosine squared of theta divided by cosine squared of theta. So having looked at this, all we've done is applied some basic fraction work, as well as what? A quotient identity and a reciprocal identity. Having done that, though, I submit that we're actually almost there. Take a look on the outside. We have cosine squared, and it's being multiplied by something over cosine squared. Well, that means those two just divide out to 1. Cosine squared over cosine squared is 1. Now that leaves us instead with just a single fraction, if I want to write it that way. It has 1 minus cosine squared of theta divided by sine squared of theta. And of course, our goal is to let this entire thing equal 1. Well, the truth is, if we now go back to the most basic of Pythagorean identities, 1 minus cosine squared is just equal to sine squared. It's one of the more basic Pythagorean identities, which means it's more likely we recognize it. So that means on the left, we now just have sine squared over sine squared, and sine squared divided by sine squared is just as 1 as anything else divided by itself. So in other words, we are done. Huh, you could say we've won. It's a little more sinister laugh than I was looking for, but the idea is, hey, good job. Nice job. Pat yourself on the back. Like, you did that one well. Like, in this case, we pretended like we didn't know any Pythagorean identities. Truth is, they would have made our work a lot faster. But the thought is, if you're not sure where to go or you're not 100% comfortable with a particular type of identity, changing everything to sines and cosines often will do the trick for you and will kind of clean up and make it so if you feel like you're in a really comfortable sandbox here. Sines and cosines, familiar territory, very clean to work with. And the last tip is just kind of a general strategy, is when you're digging into trig identities, again, we're not going to give you the super hard ones here. That's not the goal of this online learning, but for future reference, it might be. These aren't going to be the most intense and wild trig identities. They're going to be fairly tame. But having said that, if you feel like you're stymied by one and just kind of stuck in place, the truth is just try something. And I'll pull out a clip from one of my favorite movies, Zootopia, in which the key song was Try Everything, sung by Shakira, playing Gazelle, I want to say is the name of the character. And basically the idea is just try something. Like, try whatever identity you see. Looking at something and you're like, oh, I think that's 1 over sine. If you can't get anywhere else, at least do that. Because 1, it gets you moving in a good direction, and maybe that will be the tipping point that just kind of opens up the whole problem. And 2, at the very least, if you were being graded on this and being assessed on it, you'd have made a positive move, which would earn you some points. And the truth is, at the end of the day, if you're not sure how to do it or you don't think you can get to the answer, at least try to maximize the score that you can get for the work that you've done and demonstrate the understanding you do have of those fundamental identities. Having said that, that brings to an end our little lesson. So what we did in this case was talk about the process called verifying trig identities, in which we try to show that one side equals the other. This is just kind of like having a simplification problem where you know what the answer is going to be. So your job is just to kind of communicate the process you use to get from one point to the other. We did talk about how important it is to start in one place and end on the other side and not modify both sides, and connected that to a treasure map. And I hope that you are going to do it correctly from here on. After that, we talked about the tips. First, starting on the more complicated side so that you have a little bit more to work with, so that you don't have to kind of dirty up the right side, the clean side, as you start to work through. Second, we talked about just substituting fundamental identities. So picking out something you see and putting in a very basic identity will oftentimes clean up some of the structural issues that cause one side to look complicated versus the other. Third, we talked about looking for opportunities to factor, to multiply, or maybe add fractions. And in fact, we saw even more than that. Sometimes it's helpful to even break apart or decompose a particular rational expression so that that way you have two different parts to kind of clean up. So I added separate in there, but it's kind of up to you how you want to think about it. The fourth one, a strategy you're not going to be assessed on, it will not appear on your assignments, but Steph definitely could in the future, is that you'll want to rationalize with a conjugate. If you see a denominator in particular that has a 1 minus sign or 1 minus cosine or something that looks like a Pythagorean identity without the squared. So if there's no squared down there, multiplying up and down by its conjugate will produce the difference of squares that will allow you to get that squared minus squared kind of structure going. Tip 5 is to take a hint, just kind of look at what kind of structure's in there, in particular the arguments or if there are squares, to decide whether or not you might want to apply a cofunction or an even odd identity. Oftentimes that's all it really takes, so keep an eye out for that for sure. Tip 6 then points out that if all else fails, it's a great idea just to transform everything into sines and cosines, simply because we know them the best, and the identities oftentimes do devolve into sine and cosine. Think about like Pythagorean, for instance, where we can always break everything down into sine squared plus cosine squared. So having said that, if you're not sure of where to go, if for instance in a problem like this one, you don't see the secant squared minus 1 equal to tangent squared, you can transform everything into sines and cosines, and although it might take you longer, you definitely end up in the same place that you would have otherwise. And again, it's not so much the path length that's important, it's getting to that correct conclusion that really matters. And then last but not least, if you're not sure what to do, just try something. Try everything you can at your disposal. Transform a secant into 1 over cosine. Transform a cosine into 1 over secant. Just try something so that obviously you start moving in a forward direction. Maybe it'll be fruitful, maybe it won't, but at least you're moving somewhere. And two, if someone's scoring your work, you'll be sure to get some points for correctly applying at least a few identities. So really, there's no wrong way to go except to stop. Just try to keep moving forward, and things will work in your favor. Having said that, that completes my contribution here in the Trig Identities unit in this short little 3-video series. I hope it's been very helpful to you and given you some insight into the process of working through trig identities. I'm going to go render this video and then work on writing up solutions for your problem sets that put together for you. And I hope that you're all staying safe and having a good time. And as I mentioned at the beginning of this series, I'll look forward to teaching you in calculus next year or in the future at some point. So thank you all. And have a great night.